Hello everyone. Today we are going to start with transmission lines. It is unit number 5th of electromagnetic subject. This subject belongs to third year of electronics and telecommunication engineering of Savitribai Phule Pune University. Major topics of today's session is transmission line, primary and secondary constant. We are going to see various derivations, distortion in transmission lines. Myself, Professor Amit Kumar Mishra. I'm having total year of experience 10 and my domain expertise is of also 10 years. Let's start with this. First is various types of transmission line. So you can see over here the various transmission lines are coaxial cable, parallel wire transmission line, microstrip line, unbalanced line. As the name suggests, the transmission line is a structure which can transport electrical energy from one point to another. At low frequencies, a transmission line consists of two linear conductors separated by a distance. When an electrical source is applied between the two conductors, the line gets energized and electrical energy flows along the length of the conductors. A two-conductor transmission line may appear in any of the forms shown in the figure. Coaxial cable. Various types of transmission line. The first one is coaxial cable. Consists of solid conducting rod surrounded by the two conductors. This line has good isolation of electrical energy and therefore has low electromagnetic interference. Second is parallel wire transmission line. Consists of two parallel conducting rods. In this case, the electrical energy is distributed between and around the rods. Theoretically, the electric and magnetic fields extend over the infinite distance. Through their strength, reduces as the distance from the line. Obviously, this line has higher EMI. Microstrip line consists of dielectric substrate having ground plane on one side and a thin metallic strip on other side. The majority of fields are confined in the dielectric substrate between the strip and the ground plane. Some fringing field exists above the substrate which decay rapidly as a function of height. This line is usually found in the printed circuit boards at high frequencies. Balanced and unbalanced line. If the two conductors are symmetric around the ground, then the line is called as balanced line. Otherwise, the line is an unbalanced line. Transmission line A, C, D are unbalanced line, whereas line B is a balanced line. You can see this in figure over here. Transmission line parameters. There are two types of transmission line parameters. One is primary line constant, second one is secondary line constant. Primary line constant. So the various primary parameters are resistance, inductance, and conductance. First of all, resistance. So transmission lines are made up of conducting wires. These are not pure conductors and have some resistance per unit length, depending on the type of conductor used. Hence, resistance does not exist throughout the wire. Inductance. A wire carrying current gives rise to inductance. Since current is present in the line, the conductor is surrounded and linked by magnetic flux, and this phenomena demonstrates its effect in the distributed inductance all along the lines. Third type of primary constant is capacitance. Capacitance is formed when two conducting wires are separated by a dielectric material in between them. Transmission lines also have two current carrying conductors and dielectric between them. The dielectric may be air or core material or dielectric substrate. Thus, the distributed capacitance exists throughout the wire. Conductance, G. The dielectric or insulator of the transmission line may not be perfect because of leaky capacitance. A leakage current flows and leakage conductance G exists between the conductor throughout its length. Common transmission line. Common transmission line. Parameters, resistance. For coaxial line, its value is 1 upon 2 pi del sigma C into 1 by A plus 1 by B. For two wire line, it is 1 by pi A del sigma C. And for parallel line, it is 2 by omega del sigma C. For inductance, For cohesion line, it is mu upon 2 pi natural logarithm of V by A. For two wire line, it is mu upon pi cos H inverse D by 2A. And for parallel line, mu D upon omega. G, that for cohesion line, it is 2 pi sigma upon natural logarithm of V by A. For two wire line, it is pi sigma upon cos of H inverse D by 2A. And for parallel line, it is sigma W upon D. Capacitance for cohesion line, it is 2 pi permittivity upon natural logarithm of V by A. For two wire, it is pi permittivity upon cos of H inverse D by 2A. And for parallel line, it is permittivity into omega upon D. There is a note in that this del is equal to 1 by under root of pi f mu c sigma c, which is skin depth of the conductor. Now let's see about the secondary line constants. So the various secondary line constants are characteristic impedance denoted by Z naught, propagation constant gamma, attenuation constant alpha, and phase constant beta. These are again expressed per unit length. These constants vary with frequency and also depend on primary line constants. But primary line constants are independent of frequency. Relation between primary and secondary line constant. As in figure, consider a short length line of L kilometer long. The short line has a resistance RL, inductance L with small l, and capacitance C with small l. So this is a line of length L. This is its equivalent T structure, and this is T network. Total series impedance Z1 is equal to R plus j omega L into small l. Total shunt impedance Z2 is equal to 1 upon G plus j omega C into L ohm. Determination of Z0 in terms of primary constant. For T section, characteristic impedance Z0 is equal to under root of Z1 square upon 4 plus Z1 into Z2. Putting Z1 is equal to R plus j omega L into L and Z2 is equal to 1 upon G plus j omega L into L in above equation, we are going to get Z0 is equal to under root of R plus j omega L square upon 4 plus R plus j omega L upon G plus j omega C. As small l tends to 0, the line impedance will be equal to characteristic impedance. Z0 is equal to under root of R plus j omega L upon G plus j omega C, which is equal to under root of Z by Y, where Z is equal to R plus j omega L, which is total series impedance per unit length, and Y is equal to G plus j omega C, that is total shunt admittance per unit length. Determination of Z0 in terms of primary constant. Characteristic impedance in terms of magnitude and phase. Z0 is equal to, it will be given by this term, that is nothing but Z0 is equal to this one. When omega is small, that means for low frequency, Z0 will be under root of R by G. And when omega is large, that is for high frequency, Z0 is equal to under root of L by C. This graph is a variation of, shows variations of Z0 with respect to frequency. So this is Z0 versus frequency. It is like you can say starting, you can see over here, starting it is under root of R by G and then it is decreasing. Minimum value is under root of L by C. Determination of propagation constant gamma in terms of primary constant. For T network, we have e raised to power gamma L is equal to 1 plus Z1 upon 2 Z2 plus Z0 upon Z2. Putting the values of Z1, Z2, we get e raised to power gamma L is equal to 1 plus R plus j omega L into G plus j omega C L square upon 2 plus Z0 into G plus j omega C into L. Then we are going to get e raised to power gamma L is equal to this. We know that exponentially e raised to power gamma L will be represented by 1 plus gamma L plus gamma square L square, so on. Comparing equation D and E, that means if we compare these two equations, last two equations, then we can write gamma is equal to under root of R plus j omega L into G plus j omega C, that is equal to under root of ZY. But gamma can be written in terms of magnitude and phase form. So gamma is equal to alpha plus j beta, which is equal to p cos theta plus j p sin theta. Propagation constant can be written as in terms of attenuation constant per unit length and phase constant per unit length. By comparing this equation, just we have seen this one. Now, how to determine alpha and beta? So gamma will be given by this. Gamma, that is this one, which is equal to alpha plus j beta. If we square both sides, so we can write as under root of, if you find the magnitude of this, we can write gamma magnitude will be under root of alpha square plus beta square. So if we compare this, we are going to get under root of alpha square plus beta square is equal to this. If you square both sides, so we are going to get equation A. Then again, if you square, we are going to get alpha plus j beta square is equal to r plus j omega l into g plus j omega c. If you apply alpha plus j omega square, that means a plus b square, it will be a square plus b square plus 2ab. So that is alpha square minus beta square plus 2j alpha beta, which is equal to this. If we compare real and imaginary part in this equation, we are going to get alpha square minus beta square is equal to rg minus omega square lc. Adding equation a and b, we get alpha is equal to under root of half of under root of r square plus omega square l square, g square plus omega square c square plus rg minus omega square lc, and beta is equal to, in place of plus here it will be minus. So in this way we are going to get alpha and beta. Now suppose r is very much greater than omega l and g is very much less than omega c. In that case, z naught will be under root of r by omega c with an angle of minus 45 degree. Propagation constant gamma will be under root of omega cr, angle 45 degree. So this gamma will be under root of omega rc upon 2 plus j of omega rc upon 2, that is alpha plus j beta. Alpha will be under root of omega rc by 2 napiers per kilometer, and beta is equal to under root of omega rc by 2 radians per kilometer. Let's see the next one, that is distortions in a transmission line. There are majorly three distortions. One is frequency distortion, second is phase or delay distortion, and third is impedance distortion. Distortions in a transmission line. Distortion due to Z naught vary with time reduced. For distortionless line, L by R is equal to C by G constant. So Z naught is equal to under root of R plus J omega L upon G plus J omega C. If I take R common from numerator and g common from denominator, I'm going to get z naught is equal to under root of r by g with an angle of 0 degree. Distortion due to alpha vary with respect to time. For this equation, if I square both sides, I'm going to get alpha, gamma square is equal to rg plus j omega rc plus j omega gl minus omega square lc. If rg is equal to lc, then rg plus lc is equal to 2 under root of rg lc. Here, we know that gamma is alpha plus j beta. By squaring both sides, we can write alpha is equal to under root of rg and beta is equal to omega into under root of lc. Distortion due to v vary with frequency and is reduced from equations. Gamma square is equal to under root of rg plus j omega under root of lc square. So gamma is equal to alpha plus j beta. If we compare both, we are going to get alpha is equal to under root of rg and beta is equal to omega into under root of lc. We know velocity is omega by beta. If you substitute the beta from here in this equation, we are going to get velocity v is equal to omega upon omega into under root of lc, that is 1 upon lc, under root of lc. Lossless and distortionless line. Lossless line, r is equal to g is equal to 0, z naught is equal to under root of r plus j omega l upon g plus j omega c. So z naught is equal to under root of l by c. Propagation constant. So gamma is equal to under root of r plus j omega l into g plus j omega c. For above condition, gamma is equal to j omega under root of lc and beta is equal to omega into under root of lc. Alpha will be 0. V will be under root of 1 upon under root of lc. The condition is lossless line. For lossless line, r is equal to g is equal to 0. Distortionless line, RC is equal to LG. So So gamma square is equal to under root of RG plus j omega under root of LC, its whole square. Alpha will be under root of RG, beta is equal to omega into under root of LC. V is equal to omega by beta. So we will get V is equal to 1 upon under root of LC. Open and short circuited line. In transmission line, there are two waves traveling in opposite direction on a line between receiving and sending ends. These two waves will be added when are in phase and will cancel when out of phase on the line. The point where these waves are added is called antinodes, while nodes are the points on the line where these waves cancel out. In a shorted end open circuited line, complete reflection occurs. This will result in a standing wave on the line, open circuited line. When two points are open, then there exists a voltage between two points, but current will be zero. Thus, the impedance at open end will be infinite. At a lambda by 4 distance from open end, incident wave will be 90 degree earlier and reflected wave will be 90 degree later than the open end. Thus, two waves are 180 degree out of phase. At this point, minima occurs while maxima are produced at a distance from the open end. The current and voltage distribution along the line is shown in the figure. This is the figure for that. Voltage and current distribution for lossless line. This is for open circuited line. This is for short circuited line. Input impedance of short and open circuited line. So this is for open circuited line. Zin is equal to ZOC. IR is equal to 0. And for short circuited line, Zin is equal to ZSC and VR is equal to 0. Input impedance of open and short circuited line. In this lesson, we have learned about transmission line, primary and secondary constants, derivations, we have seen various derivations, and we have seen distortions in transmission line.